opportunity to do something fun with your friends and family and relatives on the weekend. So we are doing flights in our seaplane off of the beach at Hemingway's. We're doing introductory flight lessons off the beach, wind and waves permitting, which is a lot of fun. Come on out, have lunch on the deck or at the tiki bar with your friends and family, and come take a flight with us in the seaplane. We have materials about all of the above programs over here on the table. Tonight's speaker is John Kutcher. John is one of our local examiners over here at the flight school. He also happens to be probably the longest resume I know of in the aviation world.
Not quite.
He's done a little of everything, flying airliners, flying for the Navy, and flying corporate, flying around in a Cessna 150 tail dragger, and his latest creation, of course, is flying around in an RV-7 as well. But he's done a little of everything in the aviation world, and this evening he's going to be giving a program all about being an airline pilot and answering questions about what it's really like to be an airline pilot and some of the misconceptions that people often have about it.
Good evening. Thanks, and thanks for coming. It's great. Those of us that like to hang out at the airport love people that hang out at airports. I promise this is the last thing I'll ever read to you. I can't stand people that do PowerPoints and then read to me, but I'm going to do this because I think I love the tone that it sets. When I grew up, I wanted to be a pilot because it's a fun job and it's easy to do. That's why there are so many pilots flying around these days. Pilots don't need much school. They just have to learn to read numbers so that they can read instruments. I guess they should be able to read roadmaps too, so they can find their way if they get their way home if they get lost. Pilots should be brave so they won't get scared if it's foggy, and they can't see or if a wing or a motor falls off. They should stay calm so they'll know what to do. Pilots have to have good eyes to see through the clouds, and they can't be afraid of lightning or thunder because they are much closer to them than we are. The salary pilots make is another thing I like. They make more money than they know what to do with. This is because most people think that plane flying is dangerous, except for pilots. Pilots don't because they know how easy it is. I hope I don't get airsick because I get car sick. And if I get airsick, I couldn't be a pilot, and then I'd have to go to work. Written by an 11-year-old. Well, I've got news for this 11-year-old. Piloting is really a job, and you can actually get paid for it. And while you're doing it, you can enjoy it. My dad was a pilot, and he used to take me flying occasionally. And I can tell you, this is the only time I ever had white knuckles in an airplane. Isn't that great? We're going to see this gal here at the end of the program. So kind of keep her in mind, because we'll see her at the end of the program. You know, I used to do this as a kid. I'm sure some of you probably did when you went to the airport. Do you know that I still find myself doing this? Last week, I flew a deadhead with our corporation, where we left our airplane up in Minneapolis, and I flew home. And here I am standing in an airport, staring out the window, looking at all the activity on the ramp, just like I did. Let's see, how many years ago? 65 years ago, probably. This is what I envisioned eventually in my life. And this is what I envision now. My dream is to be this guy someday, still sitting in an airplane. I was not a very good student in school. I didn't particularly care for school, quite frankly. And I can always remember my teachers going, "Kutcher, you're staring out the window. You'll never get a job staring out the window. This is my office. This has been my office for the past 40-some years now. 45 years. And I've been in aviation now, a pilot, for 51 years. So I've been very lucky to get paid to have a view like that from my office. I know Lewis, I was talking to Lewis earlier today, he can really appreciate that. Just to get a feel for you guys, Do we have any white-knuckled flyers? Are you here because of that? Okay, so we don't have to register you on the meter here. Very good. This is not an unusual picture for an airline pilot. Normally get a little rap on the open door before we push back, and the flight attendant will be standing there with an individual that is absolutely terrified. And we bring them into the cockpit, we sit them in the jump seat, and we try to get them oriented, establish a little contact with them, and hopefully when we send them to the back of the airplane that they're a bit more relaxed and more confident about flying. We are very sensitive to the fact that there are people back there that really don't enjoy being back there. They have to fly because it's required for personal or business purposes. The only time you'll ever see an airline pilot panicked is when there's a thought of losing their license. And again, I was just talking to Lewis and we were talking about that whole process and the thought of losing your license and not being able to fly. The scariest thing for pilots, I think, do we have pilots in the group by chance? Yeah. The scariest thing is getting to the airport, isn't it? So here we are, we drive to the airport, and this is what we potentially have to deal with. If you look at the list there, nowhere on there do you even see aviation, do you? It's incredibly safe by comparison. Just a bit of review. The Wright Flyers' first powered flight was in 1903. We landed on the moon in 1969. 66 years. It's absolutely incredible how rapidly aviation has progressed. When we talk about scheduled airline service, the first scheduled airline was in 1914, flying from St. Petersburg to Tampa across Tampa Bay. From 76 to 2003, the Concorde operated, could get us to New York and London in 3.5 hours. Almost 3,400 miles. And today we have aircraft on the drawing board that will get us to London in an hour or less. And we may even see that in our lifetime. So aviation is definitely on the move. It's incredible what they've accomplished. We flew in the aviation industry in the scheduled airlines in 2015. Almost 34 million flights, or 3.5 billion passengers flew. Our safety record, one fatal accident per 5 million flights. So if you think about it, when you start getting close to your 5 millionth flight, you might be getting concerned, okay? Prior to that, there's no reason to have any white knuckles when you climb on an airliner. And we've been able to improve that safety record consistently over the years. How did we achieve a safety record like that? Well, we have both government and industry involved, and on the government side, the NTSB and the FAA are all about passenger safety. You getting on an airplane and knowing that you're going to get from A to B safely. It behooves the manufacturers to also produce a product that is reliable and safe. Crashes don't really do much for their business. So working together in concert, we've been able to put together a safety culture in aviation that is second to none. Tonight, I just want to talk a bit about the people, the training, the aircraft, and the management systems that are in place that have given us this incredible safety record and this very, very safe way to travel. As you can see, those two pilots there are enjoying life. That's, for me, a typical scene. We love going to work. We'll start with the pilot. If you happen to see a pilot kind of moseying down the aisle with a parachute on, just kind of nonchalantly, you might want to stop him and find out what's going on up front. Now let's talk about the pilot and the pilot qualifications. Most pilots that fly with the airlines have the equivalent of a four-year college degree. Most are required to have degrees. The training is either civilian training, civilian-based, or military. Through the civilian programs, they earn their various ratings up to an airline transport pilot rating. In the military, they'll get an airline transport pilot rating as they leave the military, generally. Experience levels, starting at the regional carriers now, we're looking for the most part around 1,500 hours of experience. When they move into the majors, we're talking anywhere from 3,000 to 5,000 hours as an average in order to get hired. And then medical fitness is always a necessity, a requirement. So we are absolutely passionate about what we do. So passionate that we are willing to re-interview every year for our job. There aren't many jobs that you've got to basically go through a re-interview to keep your job. And I say that because what we've got to do is we've got to go in every year and prove ourselves both academically, procedures and systems knowledge, where we're given oral exams and written examinations, and skills, where we have to demonstrate those requisite skill levels in a simulator. In addition to that, we also have line check airmen that show up unannounced and ride the jump seat with a checklist, an exam checklist, if you will, and observe our operation of the aircraft in normal operations. And then in addition to that, if you're a captain, it's generally a six-month physical. Every 6 months, first officers would be every 12 months. The federal regulations are voluminous that we operate under. In addition to normal procedures, and I think to appreciate that, this book is about that thick. If you look at your driving book that you had to study in order to get a driver's license, it's a mere few pages. FAA regulations drive everything that we do. This is just an example. We've just had a change within the past year or so in the requirements for crew rest and crew duty time. As you can see, they're very clearly spelled out, and they apply to an annual basis, which is 1,200 hours monthly and weekly basis as well. You can only fly so many hours per month, per week. We're required to have, on long-haul flights, rest stations where an off-duty pilot can get adequate rest. These are stations that are built in to some of the new aircraft. I believe this one might be a 787, I'm not sure. But it's a dedicated station for crew rest. You notice there are no windows in there. Why wouldn't they put a window in there for a pilot? Well, when you doze off, some of us tend to dream, and windows are not good things when you're dreaming. That's pretty thin, actually, to see, I think. Can you guys see that okay? If I turn the light off, it's going to wipe you out?
Yeah, it wipes me
out. Okay, because that's not a very good picture. But anyway, we'll proceed. Proper nourishment. Hey, Wendy, how you doing?
Good.
Proper nourishment is a really important factor, as I'm sure we all know. Flight attendant enters the cabin and she or he will have two meals in hand. Brought some candy, by the way. Pilots do not operate without candy. So I'm going to reward the correct answer here. When the flight attendant enters the cockpit, what is the FO first officer supposed to say? We have choice of two meals. Not all at once now. Okay. Wendy, at least you laughed. Okay. You learn early that you're going to take the chicken and the captain's going to get the filet mignon and the fancy meal. We generally don't eat the same thing just because of concern with the possibility of some tainted food. We both don't want to have food poisoning.
Every passenger on this plane will have fish for dinner. We'll become violently ill in the next half hour.
Just how serious is it, Doctor?
Extremely serious. Starts with a slight fever, dryness of the throat. As the virus penetrates red blood cells, the victim becomes dizzy. Begins to experience an itching rash. From there, the poison goes to work on the central nervous system, causing severe muscle spasms, followed by the inevitable ruling. At this point, the entire digestive system collapses, accompanied by uncontrollable flatulence, until finally the poor bastard is reduced to a whirling, wasted piece of jelly.
Okay, so much for food. As you can probably gather, if it isn't fun, we're not interested in doing it as pilots, right? We're going to talk about training a little bit. The most important wings on an airplane are the pilot. I was talking to Lewis earlier. He's built three airplanes, and he's got an awful lot of experience with airplanes. The airplanes are built for the worst possible pilot out there. They are tough, they're strong, and they're very capable. But if you don't have a master at the controls, you got some problems in the survivability of the machine. So I love this sign that was over the training center at TWA. All the training now is done in flight simulators. They are so good, and they're so cost effective as well, and costs drive everything in business, as those of you who are in business know. We can take a pilot who has a few thousand hours and put him in one of these things, and they can go right out of these, right into an airplane full of passengers, and off they go. If you picture the simulator on top of this, you've got 6 degrees of motion. These things are so effective in simulating flight that they can make you sick, they can throw you out of the seat, and the emulation is absolutely incredible. When you get out of these boxes after going through all the emergencies and all the non-normal things that you could never train with in the airplane itself, you're literally back is sweating. They just do an incredible job.
Flight 209, are you clear for takeoff?
Roger.
LA departure frequency
123.9er.
Roger.
Request vector, over.
Flight 209er, clear for vector 324.
We have clearance, Clarence. Roger, Roger. What's our vector, Victor?
LA radio clearance, over.
I love that scene. What a great scene. Well, this is what the inside of the simulator looks. This gentleman right here is the instructor. He's got the two pilots under training up front. And this panel right here enables him to see where they are in space with a map. Can see the profile of the approach that they're making. And has a million buttons on it that will simulate everything under the sun. Electrical failures, hydraulic failures, engine failures, anything that could possibly go wrong in an airplane that there's a procedure for, there's a button that will simulate that. The visuals outside are superb. There's very little visuals when you're in training Rarely would you ever see a site like that. Most of the time, you're in clouds. You're in instrument meteorological conditions. But they are very good, and the visual is just as good on the ground. You can push back from the gate. You can see the folks out there, the trucks moving around. The simulation is absolutely remarkable. When you get in weather, you have rain on the windscreen, which is very noisy, and you find yourself, just like in the airplane, having to raise your voice level to communicate with the other guy. It can get very, very noisy in heavy rain. Lightning, thunderstorm, the turbulence, the sound of the gear going up and down, everything is absolutely to a T. The newer airplanes have the head-up display, where we're taking the information from our primary flight display down here, and we're displaying it up through the windscreen. And everything you need to fly the airplane and shoot an approach is right in front of you as you look through the windscreen. Airspeed over here, heading, altitude, power setting, it's all right there. Flight path vector there, which basically tells you where the airplane's going to be. If you don't touch anything, that's where it's going to end up. Normally, you want to see it on the end of the runway.
What is the top one?
This one?
Yeah.
That's bank angle. Uh-huh. And if you're familiar with a ball, that's the ball right there. It slides left and right. You want to sit over here? Can you see okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Have you ever heard of keep the cheeks on the tracker?
Yeah.
I just heard that.
That could be in an airplane, or that could be in a simulator. It looks exactly the same way. They can take the weather and run it up and down, get it as low as they want to get it. With this training and standardization, we can handle anything that comes up. It's really impressive when you realize what they can do with the man and the machine, and when things don't go right, there's a plan. For about 99% of the what ifs, there's always that 1% DC-10 that loses all controls. Right, remember that one with the loss of three hydraulic systems that they said could never happen and did. And they did. They were able to get that aircraft back to an airport. But we have very specific guidance for each anomaly that we may encounter, and we're taught to go to the book and pull the book out and very methodically go through the procedures to handle whatever the situation may be. With those pubs, we have diagrams that give us a review of the systems. We understand the systems, but we always want to go to the diagram when we're going through an abnormal procedure, and understand what we're doing in the big picture. You know, I've got a car now, when I open the hood of the car, I look there and I don't recognize a thing. I know more about the airplane that I fly than I do about the systems in the car. So we're very familiar with that. And we've got checklists to guide us through everything. And I'm gonna say in the late 70s, a program was started in aviation called Crew Resource Management, or CRM, And the idea behind that was the captain is the leader of the team, and the captain is going to ensure that, number one, somebody's flying the airplane. That's the aviate part that you see there. Someone's keeping track of where the airplane's going, and that the communications occur in that order. And those are the priorities. With CRM, we are now using, it will have at least two pilots, maybe three. We're using those resources within the airplane and external to the airplane to work any problem that we may be faced with. And I want to expound a bit on CRM because it's such an important part of our safety culture. Starting with assertiveness, you as a passenger want to make sure, or you would hope, that the guy who's not flying the airplane is keeping the big picture and is speaking up. There were days when the captain was God, and if you were the co-pilot, you did what the captain said. Now our first officers are trained, if you don't like what you're seeing, you speak up. So anyone on the crew, and this includes flight attendants, they're part of the safety team. They see something that they don't like, they call the cockpit. They're all part of that input, all part of that resource to make that decision. Really stressing team leadership and the fact that everybody's recognized as an important member of the team. And communication, again, speak up. You see something, you say something. And every flight begins with a crew briefing. Captain gets the crew together. We talk about our flight. We just review our responsibilities. And the captain sets a tone for an open door. Call me if you hear anything. Call me if you see anything. You're an important part of the team. So we find it, you know, critical that we project a professional, predictable, empathetic attitude towards our crew and the whole ground crew that supports us. And needless to say, situational awareness is absolutely critical. We've got to be aware of what's going on. I see somebody taking notes, so I'm going to hold it there till you're comfortable. Any questions, comments on this whole concept of resource management and leadership in a cockpit? You get them? Okay. I appreciate you doing that, by the way. That's nice. We were doing so well with this whole CRM program in aviation that we had some medical folk that looked at it and said, you know what? This kind of makes a lot of sense. Why don't we bring these same principles into the hospital, into medicine, and how we work as a team? You've heard horror stories of a guy going into surgery, supposed to have his right leg removed, and they remove the left leg. You say, how can that happen? Well, if you use a CRM concept, that the likelihood of that kind of thing occurring is reduced significantly. Just starting with checklists. You know, we're here today to do what, team? We're here to operate on such and such. Does anybody have any doubt which arm we're working on? They're required to, for example, to put an X on that arm, you know, so that they know that they're starting in the right place. Very, very, very simple things, but obviously important concepts. Timeouts. A scrub nurse sees something going on. That scrub nurse is expected to speak up and go, stop the surgery. I'm seeing something over here and I don't like what it looks. Somebody explain to me what's going on here. At the lowest level, standardization. We know what to expect. We're seeing the same thing out of everybody. We're all on the same page. And they even develop simulators like we have. This is a resuscitation of a patient taking place in a simulator where you see the pads here to restart the heart. They're intubating the patient, all in a simulated setting. And they're getting all the indications on the gear here of pulse and blood pressure and everything. And they train them to work as a team. This is aviation right here. This is what it's all about in the airline world. And they saw some, in every measure of surgical outcome, reduction of death, complications, infections, return to the operating room, all improved. All of those stats improved. Pilots are risk managers. How do you know that's a pilot? Anybody have any indication there that that's a pilot?
Doing something crazy?
No? We're talking risk now, right, guys? We're talking risk.
Multiple backups.
Exactly. Here you go. You're exactly right. Redundancy. You see, he's got three poles there. Okay? That's a pilot. Okay? We wouldn't operate an airplane without redundant systems. This has been around ever since I can remember. The superior pilot uses superior training and judgment to avoid situations that require the use of the superior skills. I love that statement. Really, it's all about risk, mitigating risk, to avoid errors, to trap errors, and we've got procedures which do that. Is this a pilot?
No.
One question. Is that thing dead or alive, right? That's a pilot.
Yeah.
That's a pilot. What a fabulous job we all know about Sully. Sully also, you know, was in the Air Force Academy, and he was trained initially. All the Air Force Academy guys were trained initially in gliders. Mm. So he was ready to go.
And at the peak of these skills, they forced him to retire.
Yeah, that's right. So what is this?
That's just bad.
Simulation, right? U.S. Airways simulator, yeah. Okie dokie. Well, given that foundation, what I'd like to do now is take you into the cockpit of an Airbus A340, and we're going to look at a situation where the crew encountered an anomaly on the number three engine. Outboard engine is 1, 2. Inboard engine there is number three. And they are experiencing high oil temperature. The reason we have the video is because they were actually doing a program for a TV program, and the aircraft has got, cockpit's got cameras all over the thing. So it's good. The only challenge is, it's all in German. You will hear some English in there, and that's why I'm going to kind of give you a little narration as we go, and I'm going to stop it. But let me know if you see any white knuckles in this whole operation here as they deal with high oil pressure, shut the airplane down, dump fuel, and return to the airport. But we'll just kind of walk through it here. Okay. Anybody see a problem there? Right there. 65 degrees there. 140 degrees oil temperature on the number three engine. Okay. That's a problem. Okay, did you hear him say to her, "You're flying"?
Yes.
Right? Okay. This is CRM. This is resource management. What's the number one thing?
Aviate,
right? So he's got to make sure that somebody's flying that airplane. And it generally works best if the first officer flies the airplane, and the captain manages the whole situation. And so what he's doing there is managing it. Now, what he has done when I froze it is he has, they're only 8 minutes after takeoff, and they're on their way to China, a long haul flight. They have an off-duty pilot that's in the back of the airplane. Go ahead, Lewis.
Question, it looked like the top gauge was oil temperature and the bottom gauge was oil pressure that was high.
Well, now oil pressure, you're gonna see, again, I'll show you another one, but oil pressure goes down, as you know well, as the temperature goes up. So.
But that one was reading what, 126 or
something? 140.
140.
140 was temperature.
Yeah.
And the pressure is gonna drop, yeah. He's deep into aviation, by the way, so he picked that up immediately, but very good. So now the co-pilot's flying the airplane, and the captain now is calling maintenance and advising maintenance of what's going on. Again, leaving the aircraft, going external to the airplane to use those resources on the ground to decide as a team on what the best course of action is going to be.
Wir sind ja auf dem Flieger, der gestern auf dem Testflug war, hat Engine 3 Oil Temperature High gehabt, einen Shutdown gehabt während dem Testflug. So viel weiß ich, jetzt sind wir im Abflug und haben bereits ein Oil Temperature.
That's not a good one.
The advisor is...
Now it's up to 145. When we saw it earlier, it was 140. And the oil temperature is climbing. Right now, they haven't done anything with the engines. They're simply assessing the situation.
145 Grad. Das heißt, es ist doch schon 80 Grad höher wie die anderen drei.
Any questions about that so far? Anybody look shook up in the cockpit? No. Nobody's going to general quarters, as we used to say in the Navy. Okay, what's happening here? That is the off-duty pilot. That's the third pilot. As soon as they saw the anomaly, they had the flight attendants go to the crew rest station and bring the off-duty pilot up. He wants the entire crew to be part of the problem to work it. And if you have one person back there overseeing the other two working, you've got the absolute best situation to ensure that nobody screws something up. And obviously, he's encouraging him to provide any input as they work the problem, which is just excellent resource management.
Generator abgehängt, weil wir haben auch vom IDG, was wir haben können, ist der IDG abhängt. Das ist eigentlich die nächste Trick.
Das ist aber nachher fein, oder? Den holen wir nicht mehr zurück.
Macht ein bisschen Leute, die hören das so.
Power, Performance ist gut.
Okay, so now they've all decided that, yeah, we've got a problem and this engine has to be shut down. So now they're going to work the shutdown of the engine. Okay, so what we've got going now on this area right here is max continuous thrust. They're getting ready to shut the engine down. So they're going to put the good operating engines to max continuous thrust. Why would we want to do that? Well, we're about to shut down a fourth of our power on the airplane, aren't we? Of our thrust.
We need to get rid of some fuel for
one minute. Okay, we're going to do that eventually. You're exactly right. So they're very heavy. They're getting ready to fly a long flight to China. And so they're running through the checklist now. It pops up and it says, make sure you put max continuous thrust on the good engines. And then you take the engine master, number 3, and turn it off. And master is basically turning the key off or pulling the mixture out if you're used to that, whatever, turning the ignition off. But that shuts the engine down. So that's the airplane talking to them there. They both have books also that they're referencing as well. By the way, this engine right now hasn't been shut down, but it has been pulled back to idle. So they're getting the aircraft all set up and configured to fail an engine. In training, it's not at all unusual to have the new student want to shut down the engine and then realize that, oh my gosh, I'm going to need power from the other engine or engines, and then push it up. Here they're getting ahead of the problem. They're getting adequate thrust because this thing right now is not producing any significant thrust.
Autopilot.
Max, could you use the settings?
Yeah, it's all being done on autopilot.
Thrust lever idle, master switch number 3.
That's confirmed.
Do you see him glance back?
Yes.
Do you see him glance back?
Mm-hmm.
What was he doing?
Checking over.
It's exactly right. He was checking with the off-duty pilot. He's getting ready to shut down an engine, and he's going, the gal on the right's concentrating on flying the airplane, but she did verify that you do have your hand on number 3, and he looks back. This guy really, really understands resource management. That is just a beautiful move to go back there and say, she thinks it's number 3, I think it's number 3, do you agree? You remember the C-5 that crashed in Dover a few years ago? They completely screwed this whole thing up and they pulled the throttle back on a good engine. And they actually crashed the airplane at Dover Air Force Base because they had the good engine throttle pulled back. So, excellent CRM. I saw him do that and I wanted to cry. I thought, this is textbook. Okay, now he's shutting that engine down. And the engine's starting to wind down. Now it's down to 350 degrees. Inlet temperature or exhaust gas temperature. And here's the shutdown checklist right here. Turn the ignition off, balance fuel because we're going to be burning fuel differently, and they're doing a few other things with the bleeds and so forth. Notice that the other engines now are MCT, max continuous thrust, 96% on the other engines.
The caution engine
okay, any questions about that? Now, as Lewis said, you can't go land that airplane. If you're planning to fly to China, that thing is way overweight for landing. Go ahead.
I was just commenting on the fact that sometimes instruments get hooked up backwards and so forth. But if you're about to lose an engine and think you got one shut down, pay attention to the rudder pedals because the instruction we used to have was dead foot, dead engine.
That's right. That dead foot, dead engine still exists.
In other words, that's just another check that I didn't see him doing it before. I was asking if this thing was flying on autopilot.
Yeah. Good point. Yeah, very good point. All right. If there were white knuckles, this is when you see the white knuckles in the cockpit. You notice him staring out the window. What do you think he's doing? Looking for traffic? No. But that really is, that's the toughest part of this whole thing, is all of the people that are going to be affected by this engine failure. It's not the fact that you've lost an engine and you're dealing with an abnormal situation. It's we've got all these passengers now we've got to take care of. And that's what creates the white knuckles.
This is your captain speaking. Unfortunately, I do not have very good news for our flight to Shanghai. We had to shut down the engine number 3. Engine has then at a too high oil temperature, and to protect the engine, we had to shut it down. It's obvious that we cannot continue with that towards Shanghai. Right now, we are running back due to our very heavy weight. We start to dump some fuel in the moment. I know that's not good news. I really apologize for that. Of course, safety is our prime concern, so that makes a lot of sense to turn back now. We start to work on the problems, so I'll be back with you when we start with our fuel dumping. Thank you for the understanding.
3188, here's the fuel dump. We're going to jettison fuel now.
During jettison operation, monitor the siege. If either the forward or aft takeoff and landing limit is reached, stop jettison.
Okay.
Then, when jettison is completed
bound,
or
right?
Manually stop, must you have the beide knöpfe to drücken.
Okay.
3188, change now to the 1133 please.
1336
Swiss 188. Dankeschön
und danke
für Ihre
Hilfe.
Okay, we get the fuel dumped and now we're ready to land the airplane. Any questions? Everybody follow that? No white knuckles? The dream of every pilot, I think. At least it's always been my dream. Lewis, did you ever?
No.
You never?
Just the opposite.
You felt just the opposite?
No, it was
a
situation I hope I never find myself in.
This is due to periodic air pockets we encountered. There's no reason to become alarmed, and we hope you enjoy the rest of your flight. By the way, is there anyone on board who knows how to fly a plane?
Meanwhile, imagine being on a flight and hearing these words. Does anybody know how to fly this plane? That is essentially what Air Force Captain Mark Gongel heard over a speaker on a United flight a couple of months back. The pilot behind the wheel of the 737 apparently had suffered some sort of heart attack 30,000 feet in the air. Nurses who happened to be on board tended to the pilot while Gongel rushed to help the first officer land at Omaha Airport.
After that incident, that was last year, we had a second one of a red eye from Phoenix to Boston with American Airlines. Steve Steckelhaus was the first officer on that one. The point that I'm making here is it only takes one person to fly the airplane. So what we are trained to do is get somebody that's relatively familiar, hopefully, that can come up and assist us in the cockpit. And it makes it a whole lot easier if you've got two people. But one person can fly the airplane without any problem whatsoever. So he was exercising his what skills? By bringing another pilot to the cockpit? CRM? Okay. So let's leave the cockpit and let's go to the rest of the safety team here in the back of the airplane. And that's the flight attendants. They used to be known as stewardesses because the first flight attendants were stewards. When they started hiring females, they put the ESS on there and they became stewardess. Now they're all known as flight attendants. Whoops.
You can pretend to have your attention for just a few moments. My ex-husband, my new boyfriend, and their divorced attorney are going to show you the safety features of the 737-900 series. It's been a long day for me. To properly fasten your seatbelt, slide the flat end of the buckle to release lift up on the buckle. Position your seatbelt tight and low across your hips like my grandmother wears her support bra. If you can land, you want to take your toes to go home. There's 8 ways to get there. 2 forward exit doors, short wing window exits, 2 rear exit doors, signs overhead, disco lights, and the 4 lead each exit. Everybody gets a door prize in the seat back pocket in front of you along with 30 diapers, chewing gum, wrappers, banana peel tomorrow. I think it's your late first time. It's a safety information card. Take it out, check it out. You'll notice in the highly unlikely event that the captain lives near a hot tub, everybody gets their very own teeny weeny yellow Southwest bikini. Take it out on the tall blue side, place it over your head. I've got strap around your waist, buckle in front, hold the flight. Once outside, pull in or attach the flight to make your plane blow the tube at your shoulder. The flight students are coming by, hoping that you'll tell them how good looking they are. They're going to make sure your seat backs and tray table are in their full upright next to the most uncomfortable position possible. As you know, it's a no smoking, no whining, no complaining flight. It's a please and thank you, and you are such a good-looking flight attendant flight. Smoking is never allowed aboard Southwest. If you're not smoking, the lavatory is fine for that $2,000, and if you want to pay that for your airfare, you should have flown somebody else. If we do make you that nervous in the next hour and a half, you're more than welcome to step outside. We don't discriminate at Southwest. We have a special smoking section just for you. We'll need to show you a movie tonight. We have up in the air. And the flight attendant serving you is Wendy, and her motto is, if you can light it, you can smoke it. Come to the locker room, Mr. Avery, with the same one, destroying any smoke detector or webcam in either of our laboratories. Federal aviation regulation require passenger compliance with a lot of passenger information signs and positive flyers. Basically, just do what we say and nobody gets hurt. Although we never anticipate a loss of cabin pressure, if we did, we certainly wouldn't be at work tonight. But if needed, for oxygen masks drop the compartment overhead. Stop screaming, let go of your neighbor, pull onto that plastic tubing as fully extended, place the mask over your nose and mouth and breathe normally. To activate the flow of oxygen, simply insert 75 cents for the first minute and get used to screaming until the end. Although that plastic bag may not inflate, you are receiving lots and lots of gin. Oxygen, that is. And if you're traveling with small children, we're sorry. If you're traveling with more than one child, pick out the one that you think might have the most earning potential down the road. If you're traveling with somebody needing very special assistance, like your husband, bless his heart, or your wife, put on your mask first. That's it for the news and don'ts of show and tell. Sit back and relax, or you can sit up and be tense. Either way, so game to game, the clock's already ticking. Seriously, if there's anything at all that we can do to make your flight more enjoyable, please tell us. Just as soon as we land in Salt Lake City. And if there's anything you can do to make our flight more enjoyable, we'll tell you immediately. We'll shine in Southwest. That's what we call very cheap entertainment. Nobody had to pay extra, but you certainly don't get a refund. That's nice to see in Southwest. Welcome aboard.
I love the culture of that organization. I was pointing at that. There's always at least one in the crowd that is bah humbug. But you can see that she got everybody's attention. It is very frustrating when you're given a safety briefing and you are being ignored. Because their mission, their primary mission in life is safety in the cabin, not just a pretty face to serve you a Coke. They are back there for your safety. Here are some of the safety equipment that we have in the back of the aircraft that the flight attendants are trained on. Everything from fighting fires to first aid and everything in between. There is one thing that's not on here. Anybody have a guess of what might be missing from that list?
Defibrillator.
A what?
Defibrillator.
The defibrillator, yeah. And by the way, we do have, excellent. I have to give you another piece of candy. I want you to get fat now, Lewis. That's good. Yeah, they do have defibrillators now. I'm trying to think of what we call them. The name escapes me. AEDs. Yeah, AEDs. Now, what's missing now is these guys. Okay. Occasionally, we just get folks that are difficult to deal with, and we need to restrain them. Since 9/11, we've had no problems with people that don't behave, because we get plenty of passengers that are ready to get involved immediately. All a flight attendant's got to do is tell some big guys back there that this person's a problem, and it gets resolved. They train in simulators. Just like the front end crew does, all of the safety equipment they're trained to operate, including water operations with the rafts. The seatbelt sign is probably the thing that concerns the front end, those of us in the cockpit more than anything else, and that's the folks that ignore them, because we know how important that is. If I was standing in this room right now and I went a half a G, okay, my head would be moving towards the ceiling. You can break your neck very, very quickly. There was a Falcon with five people in the back going into Germany, and they killed four of those people with broken necks. And it wasn't turbulence, it was an autopilot problem. And the autopilot was disconnected and the aircraft pitched over rapidly, and everybody in the back was not strapped in and they went right to the ceiling. So I cannot stress enough the importance of keeping your seatbelt on. Obviously we do in the cockpit, but when I'm back in the cabin and I'm sitting near somebody who takes their seatbelt off, I give them a little story in the pitch and encourage them to wear it. It doesn't have to be tight, but it's got to be something to keep you out of the overhead. This has just happened last week. Who normally gets hurt when an aircraft encounters turbulence? The flight attendants. Yeah, the flight attendants. And what really concerns me is those carts. Those carts are very, very heavy. And so this is the biggest danger, I think, that we face back in the cabin. The airplane does not have any problem with the turbulence. The aircraft is built to take it. You know, we're a boat on the ocean, and we're used to doing this. But when things aren't strapped down, this is like rough weather in a boat. It can make a mess of things. So when you hear the flight attendant say, "We're not serving," they're generally strapping in. You want to make darn sure that you're strapped in as well. You can see what a mess it made of that airplane. And that can occur in a matter of seconds. If you've ever flying along and you feel the airplane just boom like that, mm-hmm. and that's it, this is what's happening. You're flying through the wake of another aircraft. Now, ATC is very sensitive to this, and we keep proper separation and so forth, but occasionally conditions are such that you can be in a descent, you're crossing the path of another aircraft, and you fly through their wake, and it's a very, very quick, sudden jolt. And that's what's happening. Talk about the ground team that supports us. Very extensive, starting with the maintenance folks. This right here is a picture of a maintenance man basically communicating with the airplane now. What we're able to do, this is an Airbus A380, and he's going in there going, "How are we feeling today?" And the airplane is basically talking back to him, you know. "Well, you might want to take a look at this, and I think this may be about to go." And a lot of this information is being data linked down from the aircraft while it's in flight. And the parts and everything is in place. When the aircraft lands, they know exactly where they got to go, which component they've got to pull. It's really quite remarkable. What it ends up with, well, in the end, is we end up with incredible dispatch reliability. You think of all the moving parts and the environment that these aircraft go through. You know, flying at 40,000 feet, incredibly cold. So you've got the temperature extremes that are occurring. And the dispatch reliability, it amazed me how few flights that we had to cancel because an aircraft was broken. Here you see that some data. This is a 24-month period. Just looking at a 787 from ANA, they took the first delivery of that 787. You know, it's remarkable what they're able to do. The captain is working hand in hand with the dispatcher on the ground. The dispatcher is working the load. The dispatcher is looking at the weather, how much fuel the aircraft should have. And when we get the release for the flight, we can get on the horn with the dispatcher and talk to them about their plans for the flight. Might have a question about the routing, might have a question about the fuel load. We're both on the same page and we're both working together. While we're airborne, if something comes up, normally it's weather-wise or delays in traffic, they will fire a data link or a text message to the cockpit. Say, hey John, looks like Miami is got some weather delays. You might want to talk to ATC, slow the thing down, and plan on holding at Miami for 20 minutes. And you get way ahead of the problem. These guys are working it all the time. If a diversion is necessary, they're going to come up with a diversion plan for you. So it doesn't all fall on the shoulders of the crew. They're working with these guys on the ground who are tracking them. Probably the unsung heroes in my mind are these guys. They never get enough credit for the work that they do. They help us through the weather. They help us around the traffic. Anything we need, if we're not able to work, get a hold of the company, ATC will find an alternate route to get answers and work with us on a problem. The other day I was flying a corporate jet and we had a flap malfunction. The flaps wouldn't extend. Not a big deal. We've got a lighten the airplane up and jettison fuel, landing at a much higher speed. ATC did all the navigating for me. I didn't have to worry about navigating because they just ran me around Long Island. All right, talk about equipment and systems real quick. Redundancy. We've got at least two or three of everything that we need. We'll be at radios, pumps, generators. We've got ourselves well covered. Interesting now that we're fly-by-wire, we have a control wheel or an Airbus, you have a control stick. You're putting an input into three different computers. They're processing that input. They're voting on it. If they all agree that what you wanted to happen to the control surface out here seems logical and it won't cause the aircraft to stall or whatever, it allows the control surface to move. Redundancy in gear. That's some severe redundancy there, isn't it? AN-225, built by the Russians, cargo aircraft. Anybody ever seen a square tire? Why is that tire square?
Landed in Phoenix.
I just pulled this picture off the internet. I've never seen that happen before. Well, how would you know if a tire was flat? Because the aircraft is carrying the weight, right? So when the tire goes flat, they make it square. I'm just kidding. I have no idea how it ended up like that, but obviously they blew the tire. By the time they got to the gate and came to a stop, the thing was square. But the loss of a tire is not a big deal. Weather radar. We've got some outstanding radar in the airplane now. This is FedEx. Notice the weather moving into the airport right here. Nobody's flying around in the weather, are they? Now they're all moving out as the weather moves in. So not only do we have the folks on the ground telling us where the weather is and working the flow of the traffic, but we've got it on board the aircraft. In December, it is particularly nice to have it. I was sitting next to a gal when coming back from Minneapolis last week. She was a white knuckle flyer, and I said, you know, I'm working on a presentation on white knuckle flyers. Can you give me some stories? And she said, oh, I got a million. But one story she told me was right after 9/11, she was on an airplane and the crew got on the PA and said, ladies and gentlemen, off the right side of the aircraft, there is a target that is being reported to us by NORAD and it is moving towards your airplane and it has a red light on it. Okay, this was on the 24th. This was on, and they were flying into New York City. And she said, everybody was just stone silent. and they're all looking out the window. Nobody got the joke, obviously. But we love to do this. I've done this a number of times where we will say, if there's any kids on, look out to the right, and there'll be another airplane out there with a red light flashing. If you're not familiar with this program, you too can have radar on your phone. This is an excellent program. It's called My Radar. Do you have it? Yeah, I love it. I just think it's excellent. I was doing a check ride the other day over at Frederick, and the weather was moving in over there. And fortunately, my phone was working. I don't think we're supposed to use them in flight, are we? at any rate, I needed some radar, and I pulled the phone up. And I said, yeah, we're going to be good. We get one more approach in, then we can head back to Fort Meade. It worked out really well. GPWIS, enhanced ground proximity warning. We've got a system in the airplane that tells us when we're getting close to land.
Pull up. Terrain. Pull up.
If we don't have our gear down,
don't sink.
It hollers at us. If our rate of sink is too high, it hollers at us. And this would be a situation right here where you'd love to have a piece of equipment that would tell you you were getting into a microburst situation. Look at this microburst.
Was taking time-lapse footage of a storm in the Tucson area when he captured this incredible weather event, a wet microburst.
That's about 6,000 feet per minute rates of descent in that.
Microbursts affect an area of no more than 2.5 miles across, and they occur when a cooled, heavier column of air sinks rapidly in the middle of a thunderstorm. As the air hits the ground, it spreads out with great force, often generating winds of over 150 miles per hour.
Would you like to have something in your airplane that would detect that?
Yeah.
And we do. We have wind shear detectors that will detect changes in the velocity of wind and wind shear. These things only last about 15 minutes at the most. And it's a shame we have lost airplanes in this phenomena. When you're in an area where you see something like that's potentially could occur, you know, why not just hang out for 15 minutes and let it move through and then go land the airplane? But we have had occurrences where airliners have tried to punch through, obviously did not realizing that this phenomena was potentially could have potentially occur, and it got the airplane. So you can see here, it's wind shear warning, pops up.
Wind shear.
So these all flash. And we have an escape maneuver that we fly where we go to
wind shear.
We go to what I call radar power. You put your knuckles all the way to the panel.
Wind shear.
Throw in max power, you pitch to 15 degrees or more, and you get the maximum performance out of the airplane. Also, traffic collision avoidance. This is a vertical speed indicator. Tells us how fast we're going up or down. Very typical instrument on any instrument panel. This would be 1,000 foot per minute descent. That would be 1,000 foot per minute climb. You notice how this whole area turns red. And the reason it is you've got traffic out there. This guy is 1,800 feet above you. This guy's 1,000 feet below you. He's behind you at 200 feet level. And this guy's coming down at you at 200 feet below. And what it's commanding the pilot to do is to resolve, we call it a resolution advisory. It is telling the pilot, you need to pull up. And at the same time, the equipment on the aircraft is talking to the other pilot who's getting the same kind of display, and he's being told to go down or stay at his level, in which case it'd be red on both sides, so that both pilots are getting commands from the TCAS. And so what we end up doing is disconnecting the autopilot immediately, pulling the nose up, and climbing to the green. And then we call air traffic control, and we say we have a resolution advisory, and we're climbing at this time. You don't ask ATC if you can climb, you do it, and then you inform them of why you're doing it. I was going into Dulles one day, and we had two guys coming out of Manassas in formation, two light aircraft, and these two guys split, and the TCAS started this way, and it saw them split, then it started that way. It got to be very, very interesting in the airplane. But it's wonderful because the gear will keep you clear. Anybody recognize this on top of a tower?
Ground radar.
Big spinning disc, ground radar. That's exactly right. You're going to get fat. You're going to get fat, Lewis. Yes, you need to share your candy, Lewis. Take it home to the dog. Yeah, it's called airport surface detection. And there is a screen in the tower, and we are watching what is happening on the ground when it's low visibility. And this particular system is the reason for those of you who are pilots that we now always have a transponder on the ground, because it's your transponder that enables this system to operate. Used to be we'd turn our transponders to standby, no longer. Pretty slick.
Is that with the blue dots on?
What's that?
The blue dots, people moving without the transponder on the standby?
Yeah. Oh, I'm not sure. I couldn't tell you. It might be. Might very well be, yeah. It looks like they're pulling into the gate, doesn't it?
Could be vehicles.
Could be vehicles, yeah. I'm not sure. I never even noticed those guys.
Well, they turn into airplanes.
Don't they? Yeah. It's probably movement. Probably puts them there if they're not moving. That's my guess. I don't know. Now, but these guys aren't moving, so I'm not sure. All right. We'll just wrap it up here with some sounds. My wife wanted me to cover this because she doesn't like the sounds that she hears when she's on an airplane. But we've got a lot of hydraulic pumps. We've got actuators. We've got fans and blowers. And there's all kinds of noise, as we know. And that's obviously the reason. If you haven't seen a gear up close, this is how you're going to get a lot of noise off of these guys as they drop into the slipstream. This is a 747. This is the center gear on a 747. So as those doors are cycling, pumps are running, and a lot of wind noise. Okay, you remember that gal when we started in the light airplane who was having such a great time? Well, here she is. She became the five-time national aerobatic champion and went to work for Southwest Airlines. And I just ran across this, so I thought it was appropriate and a nice way to finish up as she shares her experience.
I was the 11th female pilot. Hired by Southwest. It's just a great company to work for. It has been great for 27 years. I never would have imagined being able to do that for a living. If I paved the way for other women younger, I try to pave the way. I think we need more women as pilots. The teamwork of when you pull into the gate and what all happens and how fast it all happens and what everybody has to do, the people of Southwest and are great. They're like an extended family, and I'm going to miss that. The last flight I chose May 5th, and of course in Texas, Cinco de Mayo, and it's a big day of celebration. It was an event that I will never forget. We had lots of friends and family. I really wanted to have flight attendants that were special to me. Very emotional day, still. I'll miss the people. I laugh about this. I'll miss the people. I'll miss the flying. And I'll miss the 5th and the 20th. Payday.
Any questions? Well, thanks a lot for coming.
That's good. Thanks a lot.
Great having you. I hope we moved the meter for you.
I have one question.
Yeah.
You were talking about these carts that the flight attendants push around.
Yeah.
Does that screw up the weight and balance when they're pushing the heavy thing?
Yes. Yes. That's one reason you want to fly on an autopilot. It changes, obviously changes the center of gravity. And it changes it enough that the aircraft will descend or climb very easily. You can even see that in a light airplane. If you just have somebody take their seat in a light airplane and push it back a few notches, the aircraft has got to be retrimmed. When I was in the Navy, I was flying P-3s, which are four-engine turboprop airplane. And we used to love to, if we were just repositioning an airplane, you could catch a ride with us. And we loved to take pilots from other communities, and they'd say, what's it like to fly a P-3? And we'd let them, throw them in the seat and say, here, and we'd take the autopilot off, and then we'd get a couple crew members to walk up and down the airplane. And they're going, my God, this is a bear. So, yes, that's a great question, though. Yeah, you don't have to move much weight very far that you've got to retrim the aircraft. It doesn't go outside, obviously, the center of gravity limits, but yeah. And it's challenging when you don't have an autopilot, you're flying at altitude where the aircraft is very sensitive and you've got flight attendants and people moving around the airplane and your hand flying it. It works you hard.
You can feel it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Matter of fact, when you go above 29,000 feet, we used to have 2,000 foot separation. Now we've only got 1,000 foot separation. But we've got new equipment and new procedures for operating. And one of the things that we have to do is immediately notify ATC if our autopilot's not working. Because they're going to change the separation there because they realize what we're dealing with. Yeah. Any other questions? Thanks a lot for coming.
Next month we have Captain Roy. He'll be flying in here right after the 6 o'clock news to talk all about his work as a television helicopter pilot. Well, then the next month we'll be talking about seaplanes out here that are operating here on the Delmarva Peninsula. Then we have hot air balloons. We'll be learning all about the ups and downs of hot air ballooning in the local area. We also are going to be talking about the safety of little aircraft, and we'll have a presentation too about the fire response. We actually have a firefighter from BWI who will be coming over and talking about the interesting work that they do at the airport. So pretty excited about that. Please be sure to pick up some flyers. Looking for a great opportunity to do something fun with your friends and family and relatives on the weekend. So we are doing flights in our seaplane off of the beach at Hemingway's. We're doing introductory flight lessons off the beach, wind and waves permitting, which is a lot of fun. Come on out, have lunch on the deck or at the tiki bar with your friends and family, and come take a flight with us in the seaplane.